ज्ञानकोश इतिहास रामायण बाय पैक्ट
अपदाम अपहर्तारं दातारं सर्वसंपदां लोकाभिरामं श्रीरामं भूयो भूयो नमाम्यहं मनोजवं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियं बुद्धिमतां वरिष्ठं वातात्मजं वानरयूथमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसा नमामि कुजन्तं रामरामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरम् आरुह्य कविता शाखां वन्दे वाल्मीकिकोकिलम्
వాల్మీకి రామాయణ సుందరకాండ కాంటో 52 విభీషణ స్పీచ్ దెన్ రావణ్ స్పేక్ విత్ ఫ్లాషింగ్ ఐ హెన్స్ విత్ ద వానర్ లెట్ హిమ్ డై విభీషణ్ హర్డ్ ద స్టర్న్ బిహెస్ట్ అండ్ పాండర్డ్ ఇన్ హిస్ ట్రబుల్డ్ బ్రెస్ట్ దెన్ ట్రైన్డ్ ఇన్ ఆర్ట్స్ దట్ సూత్ అండ్ ప్లీజ్ అడ్రస్ ద కింగ్ ఇన్ వర్డ్స్ లైక్ దీస్ రివోక్ మై లార్డ్ దై ఫియర్స్ డిక్రీ అండ్ హియర్ ద వర్డ్స్ ఐ స్పీక్ టు దీ Kings wise and noble never condemned to death the envoys sent to them. Such deeds the world's contempt would draw on him who breaks the ancient law. Observe the mean where justice lies and spare his life but still chastise. Then forth the tyrant's furies broke and thus in angry words he spoke. O hero, when the wicked bleed, no sin nor shame attends the deed. The Vanara's blood must needs be split, the penalty of heinous guilt. Again Vibhishana replied, made reply, nay, hear me, for he must not die, hear the great law, the wise declare, thy foeman's envoy thou shalt spare. It's true he comes an open foe. It's true his hands have wrought us woe. But law allows thee, if thou wilt, a punishment to suit the guilt. The mark of shame, the scorch, the brand, the shaven head and wounded hand. He were the Vanara envoy slain, where king of giants were the gain. On them alone, on them who sent, the message be the punishment. For spake he well or spake he ill, he spake obedient to their will. And if he perish, who can bear thy challenge to the royal pair? Who cross the ocean and incite thy death-doomed enemies to fight? జ్ఞానకోశ ఇతిహాస రామాయణ బై పాక్ట్
అపదామపహర్తారం దాతారం సర్వసంపదాం లోకాభిరామం శ్రీరామం భూయో భూయో నమామ్యహం మనోజవం మరుతతుల్యవేగం జితేంద్రియం బుద్ధిమతాం వరిష్టం వాతాత్మజం వానరయూథముఖ్యం శ్రీరామదూతం శిరసా నమామి కుజంతన్ రామరామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం
వాల్మీకి రామాయణ సుందరకాండ కాంటో 53 The punishment. King Ravan, by his pleading mood, the counsel of the chief approved. Thy words are wise and true. To kill an envoy would be seem as ill. Yet must we for his crime invent some fitting mode of punishment. The tail, I fancy, is the part most cherished by a monkey's heart. Make ready, set his tail aflame, and let him leave us as he came. And thus disfigured and disgraced, back to his king and people haste. The giants heard their monarch's speech, and filled with burning fury, each brought strips of cotton cloth and round the monkey's tail the bandage wound. Bandage wound, as round his tail the bands they drew, his mighty form dilated grew. Vast as the flame that bursts on high, where trees are old and grass is dry. Each band and strife they soaked in oil and set on fire the twisted coil. Delighted as they viewed the blaze, the cruel demons stood at gaze, and mid loud drums and shells rang out the triumph of their joyful shout. They pressed about him thick and fast as through the crowded streets he passed. Observing with attentive care each rich and wondrous structure there, still heedless of the eager cry that rent the air, the spy. Some to the captive lady ran, and thus in joyous words began: "That copper-visaged monkey, he who in the garden talked with thee, through Lanka's town is led ashore, and round his tail the red flames glow." The mournful news the lady heard, that with fresh grief her bosom stirred. Shift to the kindled fire, she went and prayed before it reverent: "If I may, husband, have obeyed, and kept the ascetic vows I made, free ever, free from stain and blot, O spare the Vanara, harm him not." Then leapt on high the flickering flame, and shone in answer to the day. The pitying fire its rage forbore, the Vanara felt the heat no more. Then to minutest size reduced the bonds that bound his limbs, he loosed and freed from every band and chain, rose to his native size again. He seized a club of ponderous weight that lay before him by the gate, rushed at the fiends that hemmed him round, and laid them lifeless on the ground. Through Lanka's town again he strode, and viewed each street and square and road, still wreathed about with harmless blaze, as some engarlanded with rays.
ज्ञानकोश इतिहास रामायण बाय पैक्ट
अपदाम अपहर्तारं दातारं सर्वसंपदां लोकाभिरामं श्रीरामं भूयो भूयो नमाम्यहं मनोजवं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियं बुद्धिमतां वरिष्ठं वातात्मजं वानरयूथमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसा नमामि कुजन्तं रामरामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरम् आरुह्य कविताशाखां वन्दे वाल्मीकिकोकिलम्
वाल्मीकिरामायणं सुन्दरकाण्ड कैण्टो 54 The burning of Lanka. What further deed remains to do to vex the Rakshasa's king anew? The beauty of his crew is marred. Killed are the bravest of his guard. The captains of his host are slain, but forts and palaces remain. Shifts in the work and light the toil, each fortress of the foe to spoil. Reflecting thus, his tail ablaze as through the cloud red lightning plays, he scaled the palaces and spread the conflagration where he sped. From house to house he hurried on, and the wild flames behind him shone. Each mansion of the foe he scaled, and furious fire its roof assailed till all the common ruin shared. Vibhishana's house alone was spared. From blazing pile to pile he sprang, and loud his shout of triumph rang, as roars the doomsday cloud when all the worlds in dissolution fail. The friendly wind conspired to fan the hungry flames that leapt and ran, and spreading in their fury caught the gilded walls and pearls in rot, till each proud palace reeled and fell as falls a heavenly citadel. Loud was the roar the demons raised, mid walls that split and beams that blazed, as each with vain endeavor strove to stay the flames in house or grew. The women with a disheveled hair flocked to the roofs in wild despair, shrieked out the succor, wept aloud, and fell like lightning from the cloud. He saw the flames ascend and curl round Turks, diamonds, and pearl, while ruined walls and lattice rolled, as fire grows fiercer, as he feeds on wood and grass and crackling reeds, so Hanuman, the ruined eye, with fury still unsatisfied. Gyanakosha, Itihasas, Ramayana, by Pact.
Apadam Aparthāram Dātāram Sarvasampadam Lokābhiramam Sri Rāmam Bhuyo Bhuyo Namāmyaham Manojavam Marutatulyavegam Jitendriyam Buddhimatam Varishtam Vatatmajam Vanarayudhamukhyam Sri Rāmadutam Sirasa Namāmi Kujantan Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhurakshram Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam.
Valmiki Ramayana Sundarkanda, Canto 55. Fear for Sita. But other thoughts resumed their sway when Lanka's town in ruin lay, and as his bosom felt their weight, he stood awhile to meditate. What have I done, he thought with shame, destroyed the town with hostile flame? O happy they whose firm control checks the wild passion of the soul, who on the fires of anger throw the cooling drops that check their glow. But woe is me, whom wrath could lead to do this senseless, shameless deed. The town to fire and death I gave, nor thought of her I came to save. Doomed by my own rash folly, doomed to perish in the flames consume. If I, when anger drew me wild, have caused the death of Janaka's child, the kindled flame shall burn, and the kindled flame shall end my woe, or the deep fire that burn below, or my forsaken course shall be put for the monsters of the sea. How can I meet Sugriva? How before the royal brother's bow? I, whose rash deed has madly foiled the noble work in which we toiled, or has her own bright virtue shed its guardian influence round her head? She lives untouched, the peerless dame. Flame has no fury for the flame. The very fire would never consent to harm a queen so excellent, the high-souled Rama's faithful wife, protected by her holy life. She lives, she lives. Why should I fear for one who Raghu's sons hold dear? Has not the pitying fire that spared the Vanara for the lady care? Such were his thoughts. He pondered long, and fear grew faint and hope grew strong. Then round him heavenly voices rang, and sweetly turned. His praises sang, O glorious is the exploit done by Hanuman, the wind god's son. The flames over Lanka city rise, the giant's home in ruin lies. Over roof and shall the fires have spread, nor harmed a hair of Sita's head. Gyanakosha, Itihasas, Ramayana, by fact.
Apadam apahartaram dataram sarvasampadam lokabhiramam sriramam bhuyo bhuyo namamyaham manojavam marutatulyavegam chitendriyam buddhimatam varishtam Vatatmajam vanarayudhamukhyam Sriramadutam sirasa namami Kujantan ramarameti madhuram madhuraksharam Aruhya kavita shakham Vande Valmiki kokilam
Valmiki Ramayana Sundarkanda Canto 56 Mount Arista. He looked upon the burning waste, then sought the queen in joyous haste. With words of hope consoled her heart and made him ready to depart. He scaled Arista's glorious steep, whose summits beetled over the deep. The woods in varied beauty dressed hang like a garland round his crest, and clouds of ever-changing hue a robe about his shoulders threw. On him the rays of morning fell to wake the hill they loved so well, and bid unclose those splendid eyes that glittered in his mineral dyes. He woke to hear the music made by thunders of the white cascade, while every laughing rill that sprang from crag to crag its call sang. For arms he lifted to the stars his towering stems of deodars, and morning heard his pealing call in tumbling brook and waterfall. It trembled when his woods were pale and bowed beneath the autumn pale, and when his vocal cards reeds were stirred his melancholy moan was heard. Far down against the mountain's feet, the Vanara heard the wild waves beat. Then turned his glances to the north, sprang from the peak and bounded forth. The mountain felt the fearful shock, and trembled through his mass of rock. The tallest trees were crushed and rent, and headlong to the valley sent. And as the rocking shock each cave loud was the roar the lions gave. Forth from the shaken cavern came fierce serpents with their tongues aflame, and every yaksha wild with a dread, the Kinnara and the Gandharva fled.
Gyanakosha, Itihasas, Ramayana, by fact.
Apadam apahartaram dataram sarvasampadam lokabhiramam sriramam bhuyo bhuyo namamyaham manojavam marutatulyavegam chitendriyam buddhimatam varishtam Vatatmajam vanarayudhamukhyam Sriramadutam sirasa namami Kujantan ramarameti madhuram madhuraksharam Aruhya kavita shakham Vande valmiki kokilam.
వాల్మీకి రామాయణ సుందరకాండ క్యాంటో 57 హనుమాన్స్ రిటర్న్ స్టిల్ లైక్ ఎ వింగ్డ్ మౌంటైన్ హీ స్ప్రాంగ్ ఫార్వర్డ్ త్రూ ద ఎయిరీ సీ అండ్ రషింగ్ త్రూ ద ఇథర్ డ్రూ ద క్లౌడ్స్ టు ఫాలో యాజ్ హీ ఫ్లూ త్రూ ద గ్రేట్ హోస్ట్ అరౌండ్ హిమ్ స్ప్రెడ్ గ్రే గోల్డెన్ డార్క్ అండ్ వైట్ అండ్ రెడ్ నౌ ఇన్ ఎ సేబుల్ క్లౌడ్ ఎమర్జ్ నౌ ఫ్రమ్ ఇట్స్ గ్లూమీ పాల్ హీ బర్స్ట్ like the bright lord of stars concealed a moment and again revealed sunabha passed he neared the coast where waited till the vanara host they heard a rushing in the skies and lifted up their wondering eyes his wild triumphant shout they knew that louder still and louder grew and jambavan with eager voice called on the vanaras rejoice Look, he returns, the wind god's son, and full success his toils have won. Triumphant is the shout that comes like music of a thousand drums. Up sprang the vanaras from the ground and listened to the wondrous sound of hurtling arm and thigh as through the regions of the air he flew. Loud as the wind went, tempest rave roars in the prison of the cave from crag to crag from height to height they bounded in their mad delight and when he touched the mountain's crest with reverent welcome round him pressed they brought him of their woodland fruits they brought him of the choicest fruits and laughed and shouted in their glee the noblest of their chiefs to see Nor human delayed to greet sage Jambavan with reverence meet. To younger than the chiefs he bent for age and rank preeminent. And briefly spoke, these eyes have seen, these lips addressed the mighty queen. They sat beneath the waving trees and younger spoke in words like these. O noblest of the Vanar kind, for valor, power and might combined, to thee triumphant over the foe, our hopes our lives and all we owe o faithful heart in pearls tried which toil nor fear could turn aside thy deeds the lady will restore and Rama's heart will ache no more
gyana kosha Itihasas Ramayana by Pact
Apadam Apahartaram Dataram Sarvasampadam Lokabhiramam Sriramam Bhuyo Bhuyo Namamyaham Manojavam Marutatulyavegam Chitendriyam Buddhimatam Varishtam వాతాత్మజం వానరయూధముఖ్యం శ్రీరామదూతం శిరసా నమామి కుజంతన్ రామ రామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం
వాల్మీకి రామాయణ సుందరకాండ కాంటో 58 The feast of honey. They rose in air, the regions grew dark with their shadow as they flew. Swift to a lovely grove they came that rivaled heavenly Nandan's fame. Where countless bees their honey stored, the presence of the Vanar's Lord to every creature fenced and barred, which the Himuki was set to guard. A noble Vanar, brave and bold, Sugriva's uncle, lofty soul. To Angad came with one accord the Vanaras and besought their lord that those honeyed stores might eat that made the grew so passing sweet. He gave consent, they sought the tree. Thronged with innumerable bees, they refilled all the treasure store and ate the fruit the branches bore. And still as they prolonged the feast, their merriment and joy increased. Drunk with the sweets, they danced and bowed, They wildly sang, they laughed aloud. Some climbed and sprang from tree to tree. Some sat and chattered in their glee. Some scaled the trees which creepers crown and rained the branches to the ground. There with loud laugh a warner sprang close to his friend who madly sang. In doleful mood another crept to mix his tears with one who wept. Then Dadi Mukh with fury viewed the intoxicated multitude. He looked upon the rifled state and all the ruin they have made. Then called with angry voice and strove to save the remnant of the crew. But warning cries and words were spurned, an angry taunt and threat returned. Then fierce and wild contention rose, with furious words he mingled blows. Then by no shame or fear, withheld by drunken mood and air impelled, used claws and teeth and hand and beat the keeper under trampling feet.
Gyana Kosha Itihasas Ramayana by Pact.
Apadam Apahartaram Dataram Sarvasampadam Lokabhiramam Sri Ramam Bhuyo Bhuyo Namamyaham Manojavam Marutatulyavegam Jitendriyam Buddhimatam Varishtam Vatatmajam Vanarayudhamukhyam Sri Ramadutam Sirasa Namami Kujantan Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam.
Valmiki Ramayana Sundar Kanda. Dadi Mukhi escapes from the infuriated monkeys and hastens to Sugriva to report their misconduct. Sugriva infers that Hanuman and his band have been successful in their search and that the exuberance of spirits and the mischief complained of are but the natural expression of their joy. Dadi Mukhi obtains little sympathy from Sugriva and is told to return and send the monkeys on with all possible speed. Canto 65, The Tidings. On to Prasaras hill they sped, where blooming trees their branches spread. To Raghu's sons their heads they bent and did obeisance reverence. Then to their king by Angad led, each Vanara chieftain bowed his head. And Hanuman, the brave and bold, his tidings to the monarch told. But first in Rama's hand he placed the gem that Sita's brow had grazed. I crossed the sea, I searched a while for Sita in the giant's isle. I found her vexed with taunt and threat by demon guards about her set. Her tresses twined in single braid, on the bare earth her limbs were laid. Sad were her eyes, her cheeks were pale, as shredding flowers in winter's gale. I stood beside the weeping dame and gently whispered Rama's name. With cheering words her grief consoled, and then the whole adventure told. She sweeps afar beyond the sea, and she weeps afar beyond the sea, and her true heart is still with thee. She gave a sign of thou wouldest know. She bids thee think upon the crow and bright mark pressed upon her brow. When none was nigh but she and thou, she bids thee take this precious stone, the sea-born gem thou long hast known. And I, she said, will dull the sting of woe by gazing on the ring. On little month shall I sustain, and one month, little month, shall I sustain this life oppressed with woe and pain, and when the month is ended, I, the giant's prey, must surely die.
Gyanakosha, Itihasas, Ramayana, by Pact.
Apadam apahartaram dataram sarvasampadam lokabhiramam sriramam bhuyo bhuyo namamyaham manojavam marutatulyavegam jitendriyam buddhimatam varishtam vatatmajam vanarayudhamukhyam sriramadutam sirasa namami kujantan rama rameti madhuram madhurakshram aruhya kavita shakham vande valmiki kokilam.
Valmiki Ramayana Sundar Kanda. Dadhimukhi escapes from the infuriated monkeys and hastens to Sugriva to report their misconduct. Sugriva infers that Hanuman and his band have been successful in their search, and that the exuberance of spirits and the mischief complained of are but the natural expression of their joy. Dadhimukhi obtains little sympathy from Sugriva and is told to return and send the monkeys on with all possible speed. Canto 65, The Tidings. On to Prasaras hill they sped, where blooming trees their branches spread. To Raghu's sons their heads they bent and did obeisance reverence. Then to their king by Angad led, each Vanara chieftain bowed his head. And Hanuman, the brave and bold, his tidings to the monarch told, but first in Rama's hand he placed the gem that Sita's brow had grazed. I crossed the sea, I searched a while for Sita in the giant's isle. I found her vexed with taunt and threat by demon guards about her set. Her tresses twined in single braid, on the bare earth her limbs were laid. Sad were her eyes, her cheeks were pale, as shredding flowers in winter's gale. I stood beside the weeping dame and gently whispered Rama's name. With cheering words her grief consoled, and then the whole adventure told. She sweeps afar beyond the sea, and she weeps afar beyond the sea, and her true heart is still with thee. She gave a sign of thou wouldest know, she bids thee think upon the crow, and bright mark pressed upon her brow. When none was nigh but she and thou, she bids thee take this precious stone, the sea-born gem thou long hast known, and I, she said, will dull the sting of woe by gazing on the ring. On little month shall I sustain, and one month, little month, shall I sustain this life oppressed with woe and pain, and when the month is ended, I, the giant's prey, must surely die.